Hello, good evening, and welcome to another session of the Video Media Webinar Series by Inkspell Media. The topic for today's session is keeping long-form videos relevant and effective across channels for effective brand content. So, our moderator for today is Vidyut. Vidyut, we'll start with your introduction and then we'll move on with each speaker.
Sure. Okay, hello everyone. I'm Vidyut. I head up the long form content and IP business for Worldwide Media, which is a Times of India Group company. Worldwide Media has brands such as Filmfare, Femina, Top, Lonely Planet, Grazia, etc. Over the period of time, from being just a magazine company, we evolved into being a digital first company and a content centric company in its entirety. So yeah, so that is what I do for them. You know, when this topic came up, it's very interesting because in this new environment, long form content has taken center stage as far as audiences are concerned. At one end of the spectrum, we see that, you know, OTT platforms are seeing this exponential growth. And at the other end, live entertainment programming has taken this massive hit. So while obviously brands are trying to navigate this and ensure that they get maximum returns for their money, we as content service providers also have a lot to figure out. And that is why this particular topic today becomes extremely relevant. So jumping straight into it, I'm going to request all the panelists to introduce themselves. And while they do that, I would also request them to throw a little bit of light upon how are they dealing with this new environment and what do they perceive as their biggest challenge post-COVID. So we'll start with Binda. Over to you, Binda.
Thanks, Vidyut. Hi, I head marketing for Red Chillies Entertainment. As you know, we've been making movies for a long time. We also are creating content for different OTT platforms. The biggest change that I see with this whole pandemic coming in, it's an unprecedented time that we are living through. But the wonderful thing is with technology, work just doesn't stop. For Red Chillies Entertainment, the good thing was most of our projects were in pre-production state. So it gives us a little more time to help us prepare our projects better and even to look at content more deeply and put some time on content development. But it's a time the industry is facing the crunch. You know, no one could have foreseen something like this coming up. So, great. Yeah.
Saurabh, what about you? How is it going at Inox?
So, hi, I'm Saurabh. I'm the Chief Marketing Officer for Inox. And I guess once Bindaf makes the film ready, we release it in our cinemas. That's basically our role. I'm also a filmmaker, so I know the perspective of a content creator as well. I guess nobody in their wildest dreams ever thought that, you know, something like this is going to happen. We were doing extremely well as a cinema chain. We were fast. I mean, we opened the highest number of screens last year, and there were a lot of interesting things. But this something nobody had ever anticipated. So a lot of things are going to change. A lot of consumer behavior may change. A lot of thoughts may change. But the thing is that what is going to happen when the cinemas are going to open? What is going to happen when post-COVID era? It's still a little difficult to, you know, really say that, you know, this is going to happen and this is what we need to do. So we are all at a learning stage and we're trying to cope up with this whole thing. So let's see, as students, we are all part of this historical disastrous era. So let's see how absolutely. It goes.
It's going to go down in history books.
Yes, we are part of history.
Yeah. Okay, Sameer, what about you?
Right. Thanks, Vidyut. Hi, hi everyone. Thanks for joining in. It's a Sunday evening. We hope to make this conversation meaningful. I'm Sameer Seth. I'm Director of Marketing for Dolby Labs, and I drive the marketing efforts for Dolby in India. Just a bit about what Dolby does. I mean, we basically are a brand that advances the science of sight and sound to create spectacular experiences which actually come alive at cinemas, you know, or at home in your living room or on the go, you know, on your mobile phone. And how we try and do this is by, you know, a lot of collaborative partnerships we do with content creators who, you know, use our technology, for example, to do better storytelling. We work with services OTT services or broadcast content that delivers the content, and then the final playback, you know, where a device comes in. So whether it's a television soundbar, you know, or a home theater. So the three coming together actually deliver a great, spectacular Dolby experience now, whether that's visual or you know, audio. Now, to Vidyut's question, you know, quickly, in terms of challenges and, you know, what's the new normal and whatnot, I think, first and foremost, I personally feel that, you know, brands can actually play a critical role, you know, in winning this whole fight against the ongoing pandemic. And it's a very simple thing, by focusing on solving and not selling. I think that'll be the new normal. And that's something that we try and do, you know, now at Dolby. The second point I want to quickly make is that, you know, brands actually need to remember the strength of collaboration. You know, there's a lot of creativity, you know, people are extremely creative. They're extremely innovative, and we should learn to sort of, you know, work together, collaborate, and use their strength to actually drive meaningful conversations. We've done that at Dolby. Probably later in the conversation, I'm going to give you a few examples. Back to you, Vidyut.
All right, Abhigyan, over to you.
Hi, good evening, everyone. Abhigyan, I represent Viacom 18, one of India's largest media entertainment network, operate across generations, across languages, across platforms. Biggest business, the traditional business is broadcast. Run channels like Colors, MTV, Nickelodeon, Colors Marathi, and about 50 more channels, reaching about close to 3/4 of India, basically, through these channels. We also run a lot of the allied businesses, like we have a consumer licensing business, we have a live business when the events business, which when it was allowed, we run VR Super, we do VR Supersonic in Pune. We also are a successful movie production house, Viacom 18 Motion Pictures. We produce movies like, say, a couple of years back, Padmavat and Andhadhun. So from the big blockbuster to the most critically acclaimed movies. I represent Digital Ventures, which is our youngest and fastest growing business unit, Viacom 18. Have brands like Voot, we launched, which is an advertising supported platform. We launched Voot Kids late last year, and launched Voot Select just before the pandemic hit the entire world, basically. So multiple brands we operate in. From how life has changed, obviously, apart from the cliched stuff of it being unprecedented and all, I think what has happened over the lockdown is what any which was bulk of the industries, including media and entertainment industry, was seeing. The digital adoption has grown much faster. So what would have possibly happened about a couple of years later, people have started consuming content on the digital platforms a lot earlier. I think when we come back, obviously, so we would be operating under a paradigm shift where it would have been adopted a lot sooner than what would have thought. All the plans need to be preponed. The tricky bit is, in what form or shape do we come back? How badly, ultimately, it's a consumer-supported business. How badly is the consumer confidence dented? Totally uncharted territory. How much have we set back by from a pure purchasing power capability in this country or around the world? Some of these questions which we'll all tackle with. And from a pure tactical point of view, supply has started getting restored from this weekend as we speak, because we're allowed to do some post-production now. We're allowed to start producing fresh content, which is our bread and butter. So treat it like our supply chain has been restored to a degree. Mm-hmm. How quickly do we go back to full capacity and then start using the new capacity created? That will be an interesting one to watch. That will what will keep us awake in the near future, next couple of weeks, months, quarters, whatever you want to call it.
Interesting. We have quite a diverse group here. So what I'm going to do is my first question. I would like Sameer to take it up. Sameer, being a media tech company, how are you looking at future-proofing yourself, especially your particular business?
See, I think first and foremost, just before I take that question, I'm actually want to mention that I'm really glad to be on a panel, which has three Dolby's partners, you know. So when I was talking about, you know, Dolby delivering experiences in the cinema, so, you know, go watch, you know, a film in Dolby Atmos in an INOX near you, or you know, choose to watch, you know, a Netflix original, you know, created by Red Chillies, the Betal, one very riveting, you know, title, which was recently done by Red Chillies, done in Dolby Vision HDR, which is a better, you know, the best possible visual experience, and Dolby Atmos, which is the best possible audio experience, or choose to watch Asur. You know, Asur is another very, very interesting title, which is, you know, a Voot Select, you know, original in Dolby Surround Sound. So, you know, we're there, you know, whether it's the best possible experience at the cinema, in the living room or on the go. You know, if you're consuming, you know, music or you're consuming, you know, any you know, content driven passion point that you have. You know, in terms of, you know, in terms of how has it sort of impacted us, I think Saurabh also kind of touched upon the fact that, you know, cinema is one important aspect of what we do, you know, our, as a business. And I think I say that it's a momentary pause. You know, people who have been consuming content in its full glory on that big screen, you know, which we've always sworn by, we will definitely come back to it. You know, we will not let go of that, you know, as an experience, because that's the best possible, you know, experience of content that you can get. And when we talk long form content, even more. And that's where we strongly believe, you know, storytelling's strength lies. You know, other than that, I think to my earlier point on the fact that, you know, collaborations will actually drive this whole, you know, piece together. So in terms of Dolby, what we've also, you know, done recently, you know, to answer your question is we actually, we realized that this is actually the right time for live streaming, you know, where musicians and content creators around the world actually creating the music at home. And you know, they're live streaming it for their audiences. And when this high demand, you know, is there to capture, you know, great sound, how do you do that? And we gauged that really, you know, as a need. And we came up with, you know, a product quickly called Dolby On, you know, which is a simple app available on Android and iOS. And you can actually, you know, what the app basically does is it actually gives you the option to easily record and live stream, you know, great quality audio and video content with superior, you know, Dolby sound, you know, so that is something. So we're trying to, you know, use technology and innovation, you know, to address the new normal that, you know, we all are focusing. So this is one example. Living room, as I said, is another example where we've, you know, try to channelize our, you know, our focus right now while cinema takes a momentary pause. And that's been, you know, our focus of late.
So in a way, you're moving to a very B2C kind of environment, whereas, you know, one would perceive that Dolby is a typically B2B kind of company. So you're looking at involving the consumer, getting involved with the consumer more in the future.
Correct. So that's been a conscious effort, Vidyut. You know, we've been for years known as a great ingredient brand. I think it's a conscious effort to make ourselves far more consumer facing. And we've been doing that by going direct to consumer, you know, with Dolby On, for example, being one. Dolby Atmos Music is another recent initiative, you know, which in the Indian context, for example, you know, no one better than, you know, Rehman sir actually created his album 99 songs in Dolby Atmos. So that's another, you know, direct to consumer sort of experience. So we're trying to do that. Yes.
Okay. You know, Sameer, I'm just going to pick on your point about where you spoke about, you know, long form or movies being theatrical releases being the thing when it comes to long form content. And I'm going to push this question to Saurabh. And the burning question is the OTT first releases. How do you perceive this? Is this a momentary thing or do you think this is the new norm?
See, I think first and foremost, we need to be very clear that, and that is actually a fact, that, you know, cinema has always been a kind of a scapegoat for everything. When VHS came, kare, cinemas are in danger. When CDs and LEDs came, they said cinemas are going to be in danger. But the fact is that whenever these new mediums and things come, they only complement the theatrical experience. So OTT technically is not a competition to theaters. Yeah. They're only going to increase our viewers. Very simply put, if I compare it to food ordering and, you know, going to restaurants, I don't think the coming of a Zomato and, you know, these apps or increasing in the orders of home delivery has reduced the restaurant going experience. So similarly, theatrical experience is not going to be cut short just because OTT is growing. OTT at this moment, I think, is at a very preliminary stage and it's going to grow tremendously. And I keep on using this example ki ek zamane mein Doordarshan mein hum log aur buniyad aate the, aaj OTT mein hum log aur buniyad bhi nahi bane. So there's a lot to be seen and a lot of growth will be seen. But that's only going to complement the theatrical experience. What OTT has also doing is that we are getting a database of audience which is eventually growing all across India, who are coming and consuming entertainment content, and habits are growing. So maybe 5 years, 10 years down the line, films like Badla, and I'm using Badla as an example because obviously Red Chillies produced it, would have not worked as much it has worked now, because now the consumer's appetite is growing and they want to experiment with it. So the more the consumption, the more theatrical experience is going to grow. So that's what we feel. So there's no competition and it's one in the family. Secondly, from a producer point of view, there are streams of revenue which you earn from. So theatrically is one revenue, OTT is another revenue. So producer is not going to say, "Arey yaar, mereko OTT se paisa mil raha hai, toh main theatrical bhul jaunga." They would want to earn from both the thing. And the glory which they get from premieres, from marketing, from that release, I do not think that can be complemented by any other medium. So I guess theatrical is here to stay. And I'm not saying it because I'm part of an Inox scene, but I'm also saying as a filmmaker, that theater experience, and Binda can vouch for it, is something which right now, for this preliminary period, people are forgetting it, but soon it's going to come back to its own charm and it's only going to grow.
In fact, Binda, I would like you to add on to this because Rachel is being one of the biggest production houses in the country. How do you perceive this?
Binda,
and then after that, Abhigyan, from a platform point of view, if you could just add a little bit.
So basically, I was just looking at the data, looking at YouTube data. 90% of their viewership comes from mobile. So India has a huge mobile-first audience, and we have 1.3 billion odd population, and with a huge appetite for consuming entertainment content. So of course, OTT is growing at an exponential rate, but it has an inherent problem because you can't experience content in its glory. And for that, theater, will always be the go-to place. And also in India, where entertainment options are so less. What do you do when you want to go out with your family and, people don't go to theater just for watching a movie. They go for the whole experience. So that can't be replaced or replicated by any other platform. Every platform has its own place and its own role. But I think they are very complementary, as Saurabh was saying. It in a way helps each other because it helps you consume new kind of content. Earlier, the kind of content you wouldn't have thought of watching it in theater. Yeah. Those kind of movies were called very film festival movies, People didn't generally go for it. But now that appetite is being whetted and they are consuming new content, it will also flow the other way and they will come to theater to watch and experience new kind of movies. It's a very symbiotic relationship. Right now, of course, with the whole outbreak of the coronavirus, there is going to be a short-term problem. But that is going to come back to normal. And I'm sure Inox and all the other multiplexes are going to take steps to, facilitate it.
Yes.
And you can also add how Inox has been helping you promote your films.
Absolutely.
Abhigyan, what is your take on it? I mean, with Voot being one of the major players and in future also, we are looking at Voot growing only in the Indian market. How do you see this?
Right now, as Abhigyan has pointed out, the option is pretty much tactical right now. We've ourselves on the platform seen about 25% month-on-month consumption of movies because also movies are enable repeat watching a lot easier than say general entertainment content, which you like to catch your soap daily. And soap is the bread and butter, was the bread and butter and will continue their bread and butter without any doubt. I think honestly, the reason it's happening also this entire direct to OTT is no one had really planned for such a long shutdown per se. Like we all went into it. 3 weeks was the initial promise and it's just getting worse. So, and ultimately it's a business. You can't really keep the content ready and stay. You need to find an outlet. And maybe what will all come out of this is because there'll be no pre. So if it has to become the new normal, the number of movies which India produces, can they be released? Each and every one can be released or not? Or can the OTT platforms in their own form of fashion do their bit to support them? I agree with both Saurabh and Govinda that ultimately it will be the real, everyone will make movies primarily to be consumed on the large screen in a theater, but it's going to be dictated by business. Even what Sameer said about, we are Dolby enabled, but obviously that means that the hardware needs to sort of take care of. Similarly, the same thing, if the hardware or the infrastructure does not support the supply which is coming in, so the niche solutions which right now is OTT, for lack of a better option. And just because it's been an extended lockdown, so some big names have gotten released directly instead of letting them buy in cans. Because honestly, you're creating a bit of a backlog, and once this all gets normalized, hopefully sooner rather than later, then where do they get the window? That's where the potential challenge the makers have to do. And again, I just have a, I look more from a revenue monetization point of view. It's not to say that I'm making those choices at my company, but I know that what exactly the thinking at our end is basically. And I'm maybe talking on behalf of the entire digital streaming platforms per se. Yeah.
So that's I just wanted to add to this is that, you know, like a series like Asur, had it been a film, and if, you know, Viacom would have released it in a cinema, it would have only helped. We understand that this is the times when, you know, everything is unpredictable, things are going to OTT, but I think the theatrical release is also going to complement content which is good. And going from theatrical to OTT is only going to complement OTT release as well.
My assumption is right now, just to add, is a lot of the producers are just trying to offload the financial risks that they have at the moment. And I think that is the whole, one of the major reasons why you see the sudden surge of a lot of producers taking their films and etc. to OTT platforms first. And also, I mean, I know it'll create a whole new debate here, but if you look at a lot of the movies which have released on OTT platforms, if they had released actually in theatrical first or box office, they could have actually gone either way. I was looking at a few of the, you know, I've been reading reports even of the regional movies which have released. Some of the very large banner regional movies which have released on OTT first, if we have to look at the reports, they haven't been, the uptake hasn't been that well as much as platforms would have perceived. So I think at the moment, offloading this financial risk is the main thing for producers, and that is why they're all moving, saying that if an OTT platform is willing to, you know, mitigate that risk for them, they will move there at the moment. But moving to the future, like, I think it's going to be a symbiotic relationship between between OTTs and theatrical releases.
Yeah, and just to do a bit of a contradictory note on what you're saying, I think it's also like I look at the monetization. So for us, consumer segmentation is an important thing. It's about you define your audience, and you then you define the grammar, and then you define the distribution mechanism which will appeal to them. Like our audience, our primary bread and butter is Nagin, which changed the way Indian entertainments were made, right? So that's my bread and butter, day in, day out, number of people watching it on Colors, number of people logging in to watch it on Boot was tremendous, right? Very high. But obviously you start realizing that Nagin is a grammar which will not appeal to everyone. Maybe not everyone in this panel, the guys who are watching it also, right? So then you need to start defining your addressable audience and then figure out whether it's Colors or Inox or Boot Select, which can sort of do best justice to that grammar. So it's all about a bit of understanding our audience, segmenting them right, and then say that this is the solution which will work for them. This is content will find its market. That's what vision statement also is about, to let connect every Indian to the, every storyteller to the every Indian, and finding the right mechanism basically. That's reason we are multi-platform.
So Bindak, this question is to you. So very clearly someone with a large production house like Red Chilies will look at a platform and then start producing content accordingly, a specific kind of content for a specific platform. Is that what a production house like Red Chilies would end up doing?
So, you know,
picking up stories which are going to cater to a particular platform, a particular audience.
So it all germinates from the story idea that's come in.
Yeah.
Some stories can be better told in form of a series, or some stories, they have a natural audience in the digital space. So, and also the kind of casting you have for certain shows and series. So for, in that case, there are some ideas which are better fitted for a particular platform, and we would pitch it to them. And some ideas we would want to, you know, even if we are not very sure how much money it will gain, we will put in our might. Like, you know, there was a movie which we released just before the pandemic broke out, was Kamyaab. It's a beautiful movie, you know, Sanjay Mishra. It's a movie we believed in. It did okay in the theater, but it was something we wanted to experiment with. But some story ideas may, you know, be right where we have to tell it in a long form. In that case, we might take it to an OTT platform and pitch it there. Similar with movies also. Some ideas work for OTT better.
Okay. Sameer, one question to you in this entire debate, in this entire discussion would be, in terms of technology, in terms of OTT platforms, the kind of technology that they're offering to the consumer, whether it is on the mobile phone, as a platform, the technology, is there still a lot of work that you see that needs to be done? Like, obviously, Netflix is the benchmark at the moment in terms of when it comes for viewer experience. What about the other platforms? How do you see that changing now?
You know, from a technology, the word technology is basically to, you know, enable and deliver a seamless experience across screen type. I think that is what the technology should try and solve for. And that's what we try and do. It's not really a limitation of the hardware also. I mean, it basically depends on how you sort of wanting to sort of, you know, repurpose the content across, you know, whichever screen type. And that's what we try and do. But, you know, if you're drawing a reference to, say, global services, you know, versus Indian services, I think they all have the same workflow. They have the same acumen. They have the same technology. Yeah. I think it's the content that leads, yeah, you know, for a great experience. As long as the content can do better storytelling, I think technology just supports it. And that's what we try and do.
Okay. Great. Abhigyan, the next question is to you. So now just moving our focus towards brands and brands spending money. So what is their expectation of long form content at the moment? Obviously, television is there where, you know, they've had a good run and they understand that medium best. But when it comes to an OTT platform or any other new age medium, how do you see brands perceiving long form content and where is it fitting into the media mix at the moment?
Look, first of all, brands need to start spending money. So that we'll wait for that first. Right now, very few are, unfortunately. I'll again take a step back in terms of why is everyone, when they used to spend money on television, they were doing it for the reach they were getting, for the traffic in our language, basically, in online language. It was the reach, the aggregate eyeball, what they want to use, right? The digital medium started mushrooming. The means of consumption started getting more and more democratic, cheaper software, cheaper hardware, cheaper data plans. Everything started happening at the same time, basically. A lot of people decided that instead of trying to be dependent on the linear programming of broadcast channels, we can start consuming anything which you want. It's all entertainment ultimately, right? How you start shifting onto the digital medium. And it started off with primarily technology platforms, which at its heart, they don't produce content. They primarily are meant for people, anyone, and it may to upload the content which they wanted to. So there was no quality filter per se. That is becoming a more and more critical thing as we go forward. And it's very timely, but I think there's been a lot of news circulating around of how some of the largest advertisers, India's largest advertiser, Unilever, Diageo, everyone has decided that they'll stay away from the social media platforms per se. Till the end of the year. I don't know how many of you have caught it. It's happened over this weekend, actually. So obviously the entire environment and everything in which you are present is becoming more and more important. And that's where, forget short form or long form, the brand safe content comes to the picture. The reason obviously you need to take this call is ultimately, is the social media platform meant for content consumption or is meant for all kinds of things to coexist? The good, bad, ugly, and rather dramatically ugly. Everything sort of coexists out there, right? So obviously there is a bit of a premium attached to the to safe content, and bulk of the safe content by the content creators, be it in the digital space or be it in the even the traditional space like us, basically it tends to be long form. So people have a optimistic point of view. How this is primarily from an advertising option, because it comes with own degree of safety, own degree of quality controls, which otherwise will be missing. But after a while, once you put it in a safe environment, then you start looking for relevance. And there I think there is an increased adoption of long-form content, which is happening slowly but surely. Web series supported by brands is becoming more and more popular. There are distinct production houses just specializing in that. And it has taken a different grammar than what used to be the traditional ad slot sale, where it was a blatant plug-in. Here, you're more and more content producers are willing to create stories around brands. So if it comes with a bit of a quality assurance, it obviously is the sunshine sector. And this is where there are standalone operators which are operating. We've launched Wood Studio last year, which was privately meant to take any option which is outside advertising. Advertising still continues to be the bread and butter. But basically, how do we sort of allow you to get your message across outside the pure 30-second ad spot? That's what it is. So obviously, it's growing. It's young. It's growing fastest amongst all the sectors in the digital space per se.
Okay. Vrinda, if you have to put on your marketing hat on, How do you see it fitting into the media mix? As a, when you have to put together a media plan, where does it feature? Where does long-form content feature?
So, you know, for us, the main thing as an, when I'm looking at it as a advertiser is brand safety. For me, when I'm marketing, of course, I have to put my ad in the right space. The person who is seeing it has to be in the right frame of mind. If I'm trying to promote a movie, has to be in the right frame of mind to consume the content and also the place where my ad is coming. So I would want to be on any, you know, OTT platform or publisher who can guarantee some brand safety. They have some inherent, you know, mechanism to flag off sensitive content. So that is something we are very, very careful about. And if required, we'd stay away. If we don't find that assurance, we would rather not have an ad in that space. Because for us, being in entertainment, we organically our content anyways has a lot of appeal. So if I want to do a push advertisement, I'd rather be in a safe space.
Got it. Got it. Saurabh, talking about measure, audience measurement for television, there's already obviously there's a very set pattern and every brand follows that. But when it comes to OTT platform, it's still a very gray area in that sense because everybody claims independent numbers. So from a marketing standpoint, for a marketer, how do they see through this fog? What are those points that they look at when they are picking up a particular platform or a particular show?
So in my mind, see, when an advertiser looks at entertainment as a medium, I mean, there are various options available. I mean, let's look at films as an example. At INOX, we have around 75 million people who visited the cinema last year. So, you know, there's a captive audience which goes and consumes content. They pay high dollar for it. They also consume F&B. So there's a captive audience for which the advertisers definitely target and do various kind of advertising tactics. There are a lot of researches which happen. There are a lot of experimentation which happen. And even for film marketing, theatrical advertising has been a very premium way of advertising films. And people are used to going to cinema and looking around for posters and things like that. Now, coming to OTT, I guess that transparency still needs to come in. I mean, for example, there's an X series and there is a rating in IMDb about, you know, that it's got some 9-point some rating and whatever. But, you know, the consumer who's written a, you know, a good rating is only 10 or 15 or 20 or 30. So there's no way to measure it. The moment that measurement happens, same like films, I think things will be a little more sensible. Secondly, I think that perception of, you know, is ye agar OTT content hai, then it will be a little adult or, you know, there will be something objectionable in it. That perception is also needs to go away. So I think when these things are going to be streamlined a little bit, I guess brands are going to be a little more perceptive, a little bit more welcoming the medium. So I think we are again at a very evolution stage. Lastly, one more thing. When I talk about marketing spends from film perspective, we as filmmakers also are looking at, you know, various medium to advertise. So maybe OTT can become a medium where forthcoming films can be advertised and the same consumer can be targeted. But right now, there's no mechanism or nobody is making that effort to do it. Abhi sara spend jo hai, maybe it's going to television or maybe it's going to a selected few newspapers, out of which 70% of the advertising only happens in primary one or two metros. So I think there's a lot of money from advertising which can be, you know, targeted to these mediums, and that's yet to happen.
Abhigyan, do you feel there is somewhere down the line there will be a need to bring in a platform for measurement which is industry recognized?
To empathize with my advertisers, totally. At the last count, we had about 35 to 60 OTT platforms in this market. Like everything in India, we need to do everything in very large numbers, right? So I don't envy my advertisers at all. It's a difficult one. But I think what Binda also touched upon, what I spoke about, obviously the immediate filter is in terms of the entire quality control, right? In terms of where are you coming from? And Indian consumers, if they say have space for top 3-4 OTT players in their on their TVs or in their mobile phones, you want to be there. That's what the entire attempt is. So there were baby steps taken for measurement. Obviously, it's a very young industry. Let's also not deny that. Yeah. Like technically, absolutely, it's like maybe less than even 5 years, right? It's not even completed the full 5 years of it. It's like if you say that we are about 3 years old, And if you say both the subscription platforms, the global ones, Netflix, Amazon Prime, they launched around the same time. So if there is the entire geo launch, everything happened at the same time. So the rules of the game will evolve. Right now, it's also because I think everywhere you first supply overtakes is demand in most cases in India. So there are a lot more platforms. There will be a bit of shakeup, and it started happening. Unfortunately, that was bound to happen over the last 5-6 months. Some platforms have shut down. Global ones basically had to shut down. Because also it's about how to control the content pipeline per se, right? In terms of, it's not an easy business. There is tech to be built for consumers and the other stakeholders, and then to keep a content pipeline which keeps that tech refreshed, basically. That's what this business, it's looking at it binarily, is all about. So keeping that content engine firing, and that's where we all have the liberty of the network content to fall back on. So that keeps the content engine going, but to keep producing new content, keep competing for new content, basically, that's going to be an ever-evolving space. The grammar has started changing, and advertisers are requesting the all the options to sort of streamline that. So there will be steps taken for sure over the next, and if it goes as big as I'm saying that it's going to go, there will be steps needed to be taken. Maybe the only challenges cannot be a solo step. It has to be an industry-wide thing. So all the stakeholders need to come together to give one credible point of view.
Yeah.
It's like television has that. I'm not sure. IMDb is an industry-wide platform or not, but otherwise, every other measured medium, the traditional medium, does have a industry-approved measurement mechanism that I believe will happen. And we'll be all supportive about that. It means that, honestly, everyone has to come together. It cannot be only one platform trying to dictate that. So that I see is bound to happen in the near future.
Also, I think between production houses, I think Binda can again jump in here. The need for creating more monetizable models, sitting across the table with your partners and saying, you know what? What is that? What more can we offer? Because I think we are all aware that nonfiction is obviously not delivering the numbers. It's fiction content that is creating all the stickiness at the moment. So sitting across the table with your content partners and creating these monetizable models, I think that is also very, very critical. What do you think, Brinda?
So, you know, when we are greenlighting, if we are producing a content and taking it to theater, as Saurav very rightly said, theater forms a big chunk, and so does satellite and other platforms. So does actually syndication and digital monetization. So, you know, we are always open to look at platform which has a transparent monetization platform and which can sustain over time. It's not about something when you're building a content library on a platform, it's a long-term commitment. It's not something you're doing for a month or two. That is something you have to look at least in the next 2 or 3 years, all the content that I'm going to put there, how is it going to return money to us? So if a platform is viable that way, definitely all producers will be looking at it, because that gives the long tail of, monetizing a content. And that's how it makes it viable to do different kind of movies.
Got it. Samir, I'm just going to move to you. So in the present environment, even for platforms, are we reaching a point where all platforms have to somewhere start, that line between short form platform and long form platform, that line has to get blurred somewhere if platforms need to start making money?
I think it's about
exclusively catering to a particular format.
I think that demarcation does not really exist from a story creator's perspective. When I, as a content creator, I'm creating a story, I want to do the best possible storytelling. I will never, try and see whether it's going to be long form, short form, for cinema, for living room, or on the go. It's basically, the content should be seamless. It should be doing what it's meant for, great storytelling. And I think whether drawing a strong a hard line between long and short, I don't think is the way forward. It's just about riveting, invigorating storytelling, and that really should be the way.
Saurav, do you agree with that point?
I just have one point of view. Generally, because I work on both the faculties, one is creative and the other is commerce, the creative guys, where they falter is basically that they don't know the end game. They do not know where to start and who's our end consumer. So coming back to OTT, OTT is the best medium to understand how many men, how many women, what age group, did they see the whole content or they dropped out, after watching 5 or 10 minutes of it. All that algorithm can judge that. And if that's a little more transparent, it'll only help us understand the consumer behavior. But I think that detailing needs to come in, and that's somewhere we need to work upon. Secondly, when a content creator makes a content, if he's told that, you know, you can't go beyond 120 minutes or even 120 minutes is higher, go for a 90-minute format, then before you're devising a plan, if he knows the parameters, it's a little more easier for a content creator to bind a story. Like, for example, ad filmmakers, they are creative, they're great creative guys. And they know they have to tell a story within 30 seconds or 60 seconds or whatever, and they tell great stories. So I guess somewhere down the line, that discipline, if it comes in creativity, it's only going to enhance the storytelling method. And that's what's going to happen. There's certain OTT content which is coming. I mean, the first episode is just the trailer of the film or of the series. Ki jo trailer dikha, wohi unhone 40 minute mein expand karke bata diya. And you get so bored in the first 40 minutes that you don't want to go to the episode 2 or episode 3 or episode 4. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that understanding of knowing the end game is extremely important for a content creator. And that's yet to evolve.
Got it. Okay, I think we're running out of time. So I'm just going to move to the last point for today's discussion. And Abhigyan, again, I'm going to come back to you on this. Let's just discuss a little bit about linear content on television. All right. And especially when it comes to sports, live entertainment in that sense. How do you see that at the moment? I mean, television is here to stay. It is. I mean, everybody is saying, you know, OTT is the future, but television is the present and it's here to stay for a while.
Yeah.
It's not going to go anywhere. So how do you see linear content on television moving forward? And especially sports, once we get out of this COVID phase, how do you see that developing further?
I think it'll not just be sports, it will go across different genres also. And we remember sports because it's the most obvious one, and sports works pretty much on life because non-life sports, honestly, has very, very limited value anyway, which is absolutely rare that you get something very valuable which is non-life in sports. It's going to the future. It's going to explore a lot more genres. We've explored it with some music formats. We did the entire Global Citizen at some VR of a Sunday morning in India at 5 o'clock Sunday morning. It was a global stream via the partner. And I think we'll start moving to even more and more fiction, non-fiction, the regular programming. And the primary reason is television is here to stay. It will be the largest mass media available for bulk of the advertisers and the consumers, but also single TV household is going to be a reality in the near future in India. And you need to choose your content consumption of your own, at your own time, at your own pace, at your own thing. So if you can't wait for your Big Boss episode and you believe that, but your mother is controlling the remote at home and there's only one TV, obviously you're bound to sort of try and watch it as and when it is happening. So this entire thing, I think, will stay not just in sports. By the way, the advertisers funded model of IPL also used to be 5 minute deferred, so the real passionate guys do end up paying to get it, not miss out on that one over, which the 5 minute deferred means basically. So that will be the future. In fact, if you ask me, what will start happening further is an experiment with doing it before TV also. That is one of the experiments. And it works a bit easier in nonfiction possibly. So where you can sort of plant every episode before it goes on television. So there will be more and multiple iterations which will be explored. It will be explored by us. It will be explored by all the OTT platforms. So, and I think they'll happily coexist with each other, because we said advertising is one of the models. There is the entire subscription play. There are different business models which will evolve. And ultimately you'll have to figure out what's the one you want to go after, basically. This is where it makes maximum business sense, maximum commercial sense.
Okay. Saurabh, would you like to add anything to that?
I guess I agree with what he's saying. There's a lot needs to be done, and we are all students, and that's what I can just add to this.
Okay. All right.
Sorry, I'll make a quick point. You know, since sure. you know, If you talk about linear content and specifically, you know, to your question on sports, I see technology actually playing a lot of role, you know, in the near future. You know, we have been used to watching, you know, live sports with a lot of, you know, audio, you know, coming in from the stadiums, right? I mean, there could be a with now live matches happening without a live audience. You know, we've already seen that happening. Technology becomes even more important. What would make you believe that you're a part of that of the live sporting action? You know, there could be a technology play. Or, for example, you know, we watch live sports. We've been used to watching it with you know, friends exchanging messages. You know, so there is the technology has a solution. You know, there is something called the return path, for example, in linear content. You know, when the content is coming through you know, a wire through a smart box which has a return path, or you know, it's connected to internet, you can actually have interactivity. You know, just imagine a scenario where the six of us or the five of us are watching a live you know, match, you know, whether it's whichever, you know, match, we can actually have a subgroup, you know, conversation. Or it could be a video chat the way we are having one, you know, like a separate chat discussing the match. Hey, what's going to happen? You know, if we can't meet together, you know, unlike normal times, you know, when we all got together, you know, over a drink and we were watching live sports, don't be surprised if technology powers, you know, a separate, you know, video-based interaction, you know, while we are all sitting in front of our televisions watching it. There's another screen that can get powered up. So, you know, I wouldn't be surprised with those kind of technology innovations coming through, which will make you believe that you're still a part of the sporting action.
And I think it's not very far off, considering like the situation we are going through. And I think very clearly that's the way forward. Because a big thing like IPL, for it not to happen, you would rather do it in a smaller, without the audience being there, watching the match live. How can you use technology to, you know, kind of replicate the similar experience? It's not actually that far off, and it's not that science fiction-ish, actually. It might be just a few months away.
All right. Anyways, okay, thank you, everyone. We have one question from a participant, Nikita Sharma, and I think, Saurabh, this question would be for you. Her question is, what percentage of Indian audiences watch movies directly in theaters? Is there, is there any ballpark that you can provide?
So we, I mean, the consumption of movie going in theater is very, very less. The reason for that is we are anyways under screen. And right now, theaters are more in a limited location, in a limited this thing. And there is a lot of perception which is wrong. For example, you know, when we talk about ticket pricing, if you look at the ticket pricing of theaters in most of the cities, especially between Monday to Thursday, the ticket prices are extremely reasonable. The offers are extremely reasonable. The only thing is that the movie going habits has not extended beyond a 1 or 2% of the total population of India. Now, this growth is only going to happen when piracy is going to go up. And I think once the OTT spread happens, they are first going to tackle the piracy issue, because people right now are not used to consuming content by paying for it. So I think that needs to be addressed. And then obviously cinemas are going to expand. A lot of growth is happening in that way. So right now the consumption is pretty less.
All right. Okay, I think that was the... there's a question from there's a question from Abhishek Malhotra. He wants to ask, he's talking about drive-in theaters. Is there a possibility in India?
No, so drive-in theaters are working all across. I mean, there are the drive-in theater phenomena which are happening. But drive-in theater is a different concept. You sit in your car and you experience it with your loved ones. And it works on a certain time. And that's a different concept, which is, which is picking up because of the certain circumstances. And I think they are growing and more are going to come soon. So, but they're not going to replace cinemas. But they're a good medium to, you know, go for an adventure once in a while.
Okay. All right. With that, I'm going to end the session. Thank you, everyone. Like, I think, Saurabh pointed out, we are all students. Let's see what the future holds for us, and there's a lot of learning for all of us. It's going to be interesting once we are back to the normal, and let's see what the normal is going to be. So thank you everyone for joining in. I thank all the participants for being and
thank you for hosting it so well.
Thank you so much, everyone, and have a good Sunday evening. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Thanks. Bye-bye. Bye.